Evening. Thank you for joining us tonight, and those of you online, thank you for joining us online as well. We're glad that everybody could be here with us tonight. Let's open up with a word of prayer. Father, we give you thanks and praise this evening. May you work in our hearts tonight, God, as we open up your word, as we talk about prayer and read your word. May you speak to us. May you show us something. May you encourage us in some way, we pray. We pray, Father, for all those in our church who are hurting. There are quite a few who are going through different illnesses or other life circumstances. Be with them, Lord, we pray. We pray, God, that we would learn to trust you more and more each day. Help us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship.
If you guys can hear the kids screaming in the background, but isn't that wonderful? Praise the Lord for these wonderful children. And God, we just praise you for who you are and your beautiful creation and who you are to us, and for all the wonderful people that just walked in as well. Jesus, I just pray that as we grow closer to you, and we praise you, God, that you will just fill us with your love for you and then for one another, Jesus. Draw us close to you, Jesus. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. Lay it all down again. To hear you say that I'm your friend. My desire. praise your name. You are near. You're as near as ourselves. All we need to do is cry out to you. Thank you, Jesus, for responding and being faithful to love your creation. Thank you, Jesus. God, I just pray tonight as Pastor John speaks that that God, you would just move us to draw closer to you, God. That you would move us closer into a prayer relationship with you, Jesus. That you're what we want when we wake up in the morning. God, help us to long for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
That's a great song, isn't it? Draw me close to you. That's a good one. I probably threw you off, Tom, by moving over here, but it's easier over here. I can kind of see people better. And sometimes when I move and I'm at the pulpit, the cross gets in the way of the video. So hopefully this is okay for everybody. Anyways, we're going to continue on in the prayer series. How many of you were here for at least one of the prayer series the last few weeks? Many of you, many of you. I was thinking, Richard, you know, there's a couple of them. I was back in the kids' room, and I was like, well, I hope I don't cover something he's already covered. Yeah, the people needed to hear it, right? Yeah. Well, we're going to talk about prayers of complaining. Did you talk about that one? Prayers of complaining. You know, there's a chapter in the book about prayers of complaining. And I was like, that'll be interesting to talk about. Prayers of complaining. And we see it all over Scripture, you know, people just saying, God, you know, why did you do this to me? Why did you allow this to happen? Look at how bad my life is. We see it all over Scripture. And we do it sometimes too, don't we? We do it sometimes. So, and it's interesting because we're going to read here in a minute, God does condemn complaining. God does not like complaining. It's just one of those things that completely goes against his nature. But there's many times in Scripture where God's people complain to him and he responds by helping them through his grace. And so when we complain, which we do sometimes, sometimes God, even despite the fact that we're complaining, still intervenes and helps us. But kind of the big idea for tonight is moving from prayers of complaint to prayers of petition. And so it's not wrong to say, God, you know, I need your help. My life is not perfect. There's things that I'm dealing with. This is not making me feel very good. The situation is bad. There's nothing wrong with being honest with God and admitting that. In fact, I believe God wants us to be completely honest with him and not sugarcoat everything like we sometimes tend to do. But rather than just saying, God, you know, this is bad, this is bad, this is bad, and just complaining, we should move that prayer of complaint to a prayer of petition and say, God, help me through this situation. Yes, it's bad, and I'm feeling bad about it, but help me get through this situation. Give me wisdom to get through this situation. Give me perseverance to get through this situation. Give me strength and boldness to deal with what I have to deal with. So instead of complaining, instead of having that prayer of complaining, moving that to a prayer of petition. And that part wasn't exactly outlined in the book, but I thought it was a good thing to include. So anyways, basically it's the idea of having a spirit of complaining versus a spirit of asking God for help. And there is kind of a difference, I think. And maybe our prayer will kind of start as a complaint, so to speak. And then it will move into a prayer of petition. Okay, God, I've said my piece, now please help me. And I think God wants us to be honest and genuine with him as we pray. And so complaining about a circumstance is not necessarily bad, but we should do it in the realm of petition. In other words, we shouldn't just complain. We should say, okay, here's what's bad, God, now please help me. I just want your will to be done. Please help me with the situation I'm dealing with. Okay, so we're going to look at the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 1. This, I think we've read this before on a Wednesday. I can't remember. But this is kind of one of those scriptures that it's like almost a hallmark scripture when it comes to the idea of complaining. It's one that is read often. And by the way, we have a lot of scripture tonight, so hopefully you brought your Bibles. If not, we do have words on the screen here. Thank you, Tom. I sent him like, how many verses? A lot. A lot. I said, if you don't want to put these up, I'll just tell them to bring their Bibles, and then they'll know next time. But anyway, we should have most of them on the screen here. Let's read Numbers chapter 11, verse 1. This is all about complaining right here. Here's what the Bible says about complaining. Soon the people began to complain about their hardship, and the Lord heard everything they said. Then the Lord's anger blazed against them, and he sent a fire to rage among them, and he destroyed some of the people in the outskirts of the camp. So this is what happens when we complain. God doesn't like it. And fortunately, I hope that doesn't happen to you. That's why we shouldn't complain. But we do complain sometimes. And, this verse highlights the fact that God does not like complaining. Now, God worked in very unique ways in the Old Testament. And so in this specific situation, he, was really proving a point that would last for many generations, that God does not like complaining. God does not like complaining. And as we see throughout Scripture, as we see throughout our lives, humans have the tendency to complain. Humans have the tendency to complain. And since the goal of our Christian lives is that we would worship God in everything that we say and do, the goal of our Christian lives is that we would worship God and everything that we say and do, a spirit of complaining is kind of the opposite of that, isn't it? I mean, isn't the spirit of complaining almost the opposite of a spirit of worship? When you worship God, you are finding joy and pleasure in him and in the ways he has blessed you. When you worship God, you are finding joy and pleasure in him and in the ways that he has blessed you. When you complain, you're essentially saying, the life I have is not good enough. The circumstances I have are not good enough, and I do not like them. Even though God has blessed me with X, Y, Z, even though he saved my soul, and in God's people's case here, he had literally, what did he do for them? He delivered them from slavery in Egypt. And now what are they doing? They are complaining. And so we have a tendency to complain, and it's kind of like the opposite of worship. Instead of saying, God, thank you, I praise you, I give you glory, we say, God, what you've given me is not good enough, and so I'm going to complain about it. So sometimes even Christians have the tendency to complain. Okay, so this is one of the first reported examples in Scripture of Christians complaining. We're going to skip a few verses down the road, all the way to verse 10, Numbers chapter 11, verses 10 through 15. And we find Moses. Moses is still leading God's people. He's still leading God's people. And here's what's going on in this passage. Here's what it says. Moses heard all the families standing in the doorways of their tents whining, and the Lord became extremely angry. Moses was also very aggravated. And Moses said to the Lord, why are you treating me, your servant, so harshly? Have mercy on me. What did I do to deserve the burden of all these people? Did I give birth to them? Did I bring them into the world? Why did you tell me to carry them in my arms like a mother carries a nursing baby? How can I carry them to the land you swore to give their ancestors? Where am I supposed to get meat for all these people? They keep whining to me, saying, give us meat to eat. I can't carry all these people by myself. The load is far too heavy. If this is how you intend to treat me, just go ahead and kill me. Do me a favor and spare me this misery. And he was, I think he was being a little bit serious, because what was happening? God's people would not stop complaining. And specifically here, it was about food. It was about food. Even after God had rescued them from slavery and walked with them through the wilderness, God's people are complaining because they did not have the right type of food to eat. Now, many of us Americans, if we had to eat the food they had to eat, we would be complaining too, wouldn't we? We would be complaining too, so we're not exempt from this. We're not exempt. Some of us might complain if our air conditioning goes out, and they hadn't even invented air conditioning back then, you know, and they were in a desert too. Just something to think about. Even though God was sustaining his people with food, he's given them food. They weren't starving to death. Even though God was sustaining his people with food, giving them something to eat, it was not luxurious enough for them. It was not good enough for them. It was not luxurious enough. So sustenance was not good enough for God's people. They wanted luxury, and maybe you've been there before. You have sustenance. You have all your needs provided for. You know, you're not going to die of starvation or die of freezing to death. But maybe you want something more. Maybe you're complaining because you don't have the right type of food or the right type of house or car or job or income or whatever. Fill in the blank. We have the tendency to complain about things. Okay, so let's rewind a little bit. And we're going to rewind back to Exodus chapter 5. I think I got this passage right. Exodus chapter 5. Yes, we did. And this is right after God calls Moses to go rescue his people from Egypt. So, you know, of course, Moses didn't want to do it at first, but eventually got talked into it. And so he goes to Egypt, and, you know, he's on this plan. He's on this mission from God, literally, to go rescue God's people from Egypt. And he has this vision of what's going to happen. He's going to walk in there, and God's going to wipe out all the Egyptians, and then they're all going to be like, Moses, you're so awesome. God, you're so awesome. And they're going to walk away in the desert. That was Moses' vision. Sometimes we have vision of how God's going to lead us, but here's what happens in Exodus chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. Then Moses went back to the Lord and protested, "Why have you brought all this trouble on your own people, Lord? Why did you send me? Ever since I came to Pharaoh as your spokesman, he has been even more brutal to your people, and you have done nothing to rescue them." So God called Moses to go into Egypt, and he gave him this specific mission, go and you know, I'm going to free my people through you. And now what's happening? So Moses gets there. Things don't go so well. And basically, at the end of the day, Pharaoh orders God's people to have to work even harder. Remember, God's people were working for Pharaoh in slavery. And so when Moses showed up and did his thing and said, God's going to rescue us, the first thing that happened was Pharaoh didn't like it, and so he made God's people work even harder. So the type of labor they had to do, he basically made it so they had to do even more labor that was even more time-consuming. Instead of working an 8-hour day, they now had to work 12 or more hours a day. And so the people were upset at Moses. Moses was upset at God, and it didn't turn out so well. It didn't turn out so well. So we find here in Exodus chapter 5, Moses complaining towards God. You know, he came to Pharaoh to speak in God's name, and God has not delivered his people at all. And so Moses actually moves one step further from complaining in the passage, moves one step further from complaining. Maybe we've been here. He moves one step further and actually accuses God. You ever been there? He actually accuses God. So it moves from a prayer of complaining to a prayer of accusation. And God, you said you would free your people. God, you have not done what you promised. You ever said something like that to God? God, you are not fulfilling your promise and commitment to me. Whatever that might be. So even though we're not supposed to complain, instead we're supposed to trust God, God's response to Moses' prayer is actually pretty instructive. You know, God was not angry about Moses' complaint. God did not appear angry about his complaint. God understood why Moses was upset, and God repeated his promise of deliverance. And so kind of the idea here is sometimes when we complain, specifically sometimes when we go to God and complain, it's based on a limited point of view. Does that make sense? Based on a limited point of view. See, Moses didn't see the big picture, because we all know the end of the story. God's people will eventually get free. But Moses, at first, things didn't go as planned. And so Moses is looking at this through a limited point of view. God had called him on a specific path. And at the first hiccup on that path, he said, "Well, God, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? Don't you love me? Don't you care about me? Don't you keep your promises?" But Moses was looking at that limited point of view. He didn't see the big picture. And we do that sometimes too. You know, how often do we complain and our complaints are rooted in a limited point of view? Imagine you get laid off from a job. And that's a reason to complain. I think many of us, if we were in that situation, we would probably complain or even complain to God. Maybe we'd say things like, God, how could you allow me to get laid off from my job and not be able to provide for myself or my family? God, how could you allow that to happen to me when this person at my work, who's like an atheist or something, didn't get laid off and I did? There are situations that happen like that all the time. You can fill in the blank from your own lives. Perhaps we would feel justified to complain about something like that. Well, we're looking at it from a limited point of view because God always has a plan. And we don't exactly know God's plan, but maybe, just maybe, there's a different job that God is calling us to through the whole process. Maybe it's even a pay raise. Maybe it's even a better work environment. Or maybe God just has a specific plan for you at this new job, and that's why you got laid off from this current job. And you can fill in the blank with your own scenario from your own life, but in situations like that, the day that you get laid off, you're probably complaining. Maybe you're even complaining to God. And we do so out of a limited point of view. We do so out of a limited point of view because we don't see the big picture that God sees. We just see today, and today I don't have a job. And that's pretty scary, honestly. You know, and you might even feel justified in complaining. But God wants us to trust Him and have faith in His master plan. Easier said than done sometimes, for sure. Easier said than done sometimes. Instead of entering into this relationship with God as we experience hardship, as we experience difficult situations, instead of going to God and saying, God, would you walk with me through this? Would you give me wisdom? Would you show me how to deal with this? Instead, we just complain, and that comes out of a limited viewpoint that we tend to have. Our prayers of complaint are often rooted in a limited viewpoint. And so that's what's going on here with Moses. And because we know the end of the story, we know that God will, in fact, deliver his people from Egypt. But Moses doesn't see it here. He doesn't know that yet. He just sees the fact that, well, I came in, and now Pharaoh's making us all work harder, and now all God's people hate me, and this is a bad situation. And so we find with Moses and with ourselves sometimes, we have this posture of complaining rather than having a posture of trusting in God. A posture of complaining versus a posture of trusting in God. And this is all so much easier said than done, isn't it? It's all so much easier said than done. I mean, many of us here will agree with all this, but maybe something happens next week where, you know, we complain because we're in a situation that's bad and we don't really see how it's going to end well, and so we complain. But God has a plan, and He leads us to trust in Him. And so we need to remember that oftentimes we have a limited viewpoint. And so instead of complaining, we need to learn to trust. Let's read another story, fast forwarding to the book of Joshua. Joshua chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. And I'm not going to, you know, go into all the context. We'll just read these two verses here. Here's what's going on. Then Joshua cried out, O sovereign Lord, why did you bring us across the Jordan River if you're going to let the Amorites kill us? If only we'd been content to stay on the other side. Lord, what can I say now that Israel has fled from its enemies? And so God was leading them on a certain path to, you know, go against this certain tribe. And the battle did not go as planned. And the big idea here is that life sometimes does not go as planned. You know, we face hiccups. We face obstacles. We face things that were totally unexpected. We had no idea. We face curveballs of life. Maybe you've been there. Maybe you've been there and you have a plan for the next year, the next 5 years, the next 10 years, and all of a sudden something very unexpected happens and it puts a curveball in your plans. And that's kind of what's going on here. Life does not go as planned. And instead of having a posture, instead of having an attitude of trust, we are tempted to have a posture and attitude of complaining, as we see in the book of Joshua. Let's fast forward again to the book of Judges, chapter 15, talking about Samson. And there's just one verse here, verse 18. Samson was now very thirsty, and he cried out to the Lord, "You have accomplished this great victory by the strength of your servant. Must I now die of thirst and fall into the hands of these pagans?" So what is going on here? So we know that from the story that Samson had broken these ropes that were binding him through the strength that God had given him. And actually, he'd also fought and killed around 1,000 Philistines, the scripture tells us. So this is just crazy what God was doing in Samson's life. I mean, he was on fire. He was on fire. But he was exhausted in the moment. He was dehydrated. And even though God had rescued him from captivity, even though God had allowed, I mean, there's 1,000 captors, even though God had done that and rescued him and used him in this mighty way and freed him, he is complaining. What's he complaining about? He's thirsty. Which, you know, maybe he was like severely dehydrated or something, not just a little bit parched, who knows. But nonetheless, God had just rescued him from this army, essentially, that was, you know, taking him in, and he doesn't trust God to provide for his thirst. And we, you know, we do the same thing sometimes. You know, we see God work in our lives. We see God lead us in a certain way, and then there's a little hiccup along the way, and we say, "Well, God, what happened to this master plan that you're going to do this, this, and this in my life? I feel you calling me this way, but there's this obstacle in front of me. How could you allow any obstacle in front of me if you're calling me this way?" It happens in our lives all the time. And so we see it throughout Scripture, throughout the Old Testament here, right here with Samson. God had rescued him from this incredible situation God had rescued him from, and now he's complaining about being thirsty. Okay. So let's talk about Jeremiah. You remember Jeremiah, the prophet? So Jeremiah, he was not well-liked. He was ridiculed. He was condemned. He was even imprisoned. And he was threatened with death. This is Jeremiah, the prophet. Imagine that life. You're just out there. God gives you a message to share with God's people, and they don't like it. They don't want to hear it. And so they end up beating you and imprisoning you and making fun of you and even threatening your life. That's what Jeremiah had to deal with as God gave him this message to tell God's people. Jeremiah was compelled to speak out, but he was discouraged by the unresponsiveness of God's people. So Jeremiah was filled with pain, not just because people were making fun of him, and not just because he, you know, had to go to prison and he was getting death threats. He was actually full of pain because he had this genuine message from God that was really important to him and very real to him, and God's people wouldn't listen. God's people just wouldn't listen. And so, you know, these were his people too, and so he felt bad for them. And it pained his heart that God's people wouldn't listen to him. And so several passages in the book of Jeremiah would certainly fit into the category of prayers of complaining. Several passages. Because he was often going before God and saying, "God, what in the world have you gotten me into? You tell me to preach this message to these people who absolutely hate it." That's the book of Jeremiah. Imagine being someone who continually tries to speak the truth to somebody, but that person simply won't listen. You ever had somebody like that in your life, by the way? You know, they're destroying their lives. They're destroying their lives, and you try to get them out of it. You try to speak truth to them, but they just don't listen. And that's what Jeremiah was feeling, as God's people would not listen to his plea, to his prophecy. Jeremiah was a very tough person. He endured a lot. And even in spite of all of the opposition he faced, he continued to remain faithful to God. And that's one of the incredible things we can take away from that book of the Bible in Jeremiah. You know, even though he did complain, it didn't stop him from going forward. Even though there was days where he went home, laid on his bed and said, "God, I hate my life. Why did you do this to me?" You know, maybe we've been there. It didn't stop him from going forward and moving forward in the calling God had given him. And so even in spite of all the opposition Jeremiah faced, he continued to remain faithful to God. However, he certainly did complain sometimes. And here's Jeremiah chapter 20, verses 14 through 18. Here's what he says to God. Yet I curse the day I was born. May no one celebrate the day of my birth. I curse the messenger who told my father, good news, you have a son. Let him be destroyed like the cities of old that the Lord overthrew without mercy. Terrify him all day long with battle shouts. Because he did not kill me at birth. Oh, that I had died in my mother's womb, that her body had been my grave. Why was I ever born? My entire life has been filled with trouble, sorrow, and shame. And so, you know, I do believe here, you know, Jeremiah was just kind of just having an extra bad day. Many of us have been there. An extra bad day. Like, I just don't even feel like doing anything anymore. Like, I can't take it. Maybe we've been there before, and this is what Jeremiah is feeling. But one big lesson, like I said, one big lesson we can learn from Jeremiah is that even if we're having a rough patch on this journey God has called us to, we need to continue to remain faithful. And Jeremiah remained faithful to the calling God had given him. He remained faithful. Even those nights, like that night, he remained faithful, and he trudged on. He really did. He didn't give up. He felt like he wanted to give up. He was not sure why God's people had not listened to this message that God had given them. And it pained him day in and day out. But he did not give up. Okay, so we've seen a lot of prayers of complaining. And it's certainly in Scripture. So it just reminds us, you know, if we find ourselves complaining, not that it's okay, but we're not alone. I mean, this is something that humans have the tendency to do. We have the tendency to complain. And how do we move from prayers of complaining to prayers of petition? Because that's the whole, you know, big idea tonight, moving from prayers of complaining to prayers of petition. And it begins with a posture of faith and trust in God. When we complain, we are sometimes doing so because we don't trust God. And maybe we don't want to admit it, but sometimes we're doing so because we don't trust God. When we complain, we are sometimes doing so because we have a limited point of view on the situation. Maybe you don't want to admit it, but sometimes when you complain, you are doing so because you have a limited point of view of the situation at hand. You can only see what's right in front of you. You don't see the big picture like God sees. So we need to move from prayers of complaining to prayers of petition. Let's look at Psalm chapter 4. We're actually going to read three different passages in Psalms. And actually, the Psalms are filled with prayers of petition, as is other passages in Scripture. But I just picked three Psalms for examples of prayers of petition. And here they are. Psalm chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. Answer me when I call to you, O God, who declares me innocent. Free me from my troubles. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people ruin my reputation? How long will you make groundless accusations? How long will you continue your lies? You can be sure of this. The Lord set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will answer when I call to him. And so obviously, and I think all three of, at least the first two are written by David. The third I'm unsure, but all three of these could perhaps have been written by King David. And we know all the many troubles he went through as king. And so he was somebody who dealt with difficult situations on a regular basis, off and on a regular basis. And so we find him here not really complaining, just saying, God, have mercy on me. God, hear my prayer. God, this is the situation I'm dealing with. Please help me. Please help me. Moving from prayers of complaining to prayers of petition. God, this is what's happening to me. And yes, I'm kind of complaining about it, God, but moving from that to also saying, God, rescue me. God, help me. God, give me wisdom. God, give me strength. God, give me perseverance to get through this. Moving from prayers of complaint to prayers of petition. Let's read Psalm chapter 28. Psalm chapter 28, verses 1 through 5, tell us this. Here's what he's saying. He says this, I pray to you, O Lord, my rock. Do not turn a deaf ear to me, For if you are silent, I might as well give up and die. He's being honest. Listen to my prayer for mercy as I cry out to you for help, as I lift my hands towards your holy sanctuary. Do not drag me away with the wicked, with those who do evil, those who speak friendly words to their neighbors while planning evil in their hearts. Give them the punishment they so richly deserve. Measure it out in proportion to their wickedness. Pay them back for all their evil deeds. Give them a taste of what they have done to others. They care nothing for what the Lord has done or for what his hands have made, so he will tear them down and they will never be rebuilt. And so we see here, you know, he's pouring his heart out to God. So it's not like we can't complain to God or kind of, in other words, cast our cares and worries upon him. It's not like we can say, God, I don't really like this situation I'm going through. God wants us to be honest with him. And of course, God already knows what you're dealing with. And not only that, but God also knows what you're thinking about it. So there's no point in keeping it hidden. Just say, God, this is how I feel today about this situation I'm going through. And I don't know what to do, and I'm pretty upset about it, and I'm kind of lost and confused and a little bit angry. But hear my pleas for help. Hear my prayers, O God. And that's just honest, genuine prayer. You know, moving from a prayer of complaining to a prayer of petition, saying, God, that was me complaining, and now I'm asking you to help me. Now I'm asking you to give me wisdom. Now I'm asking you to give me strength and guidance with this bad situation I'm in. And I think that's the way God wants us to pray when we're experiencing negative things in our lives. Let's read Psalm 130, moving on here, several chapters. From the depths of despair, O Lord, I call for your help. Hear my cry, O Lord. Pay attention to my prayer. Lord, if you kept a record of our sins, who, O Lord, could ever survive? But you offer forgiveness that we might learn to fear you. I am counting on the Lord. Yes, I am counting on him. I have put my hope in his word. And so, very genuine again, from the depths of despair, calling for help. God, hear my cry. Lord, listen to me. Pay attention to me. Look at what I'm going through. Just being honest. He's just being honest. And then in verse 3, you know, if you kept a record of our sins, who, O Lord, could ever survive? You know, just being honest and God, I messed up. And if you've kept a record of my sins, I could never survive. Being honest. But then asking for forgiveness because we know that God forgives. And then asking God to help in that situation. And so I think these three passages, and there's many others in the book of Psalms, are good models for us to help us pray when we do face those situations or those prayers of complaining. So moving from those prayers of complaining to prayers of petition. And we're going to close this evening with just a couple more verses in Philippians, moving to the New Testament, Philippians chapter 2. And so we see verse 14 here. Maybe you've seen this one before. Do everything without complaining and arguing. So this is the posture that God wants us to have. Do everything, including prayer, without complaining and arguing. Okay, verses 17 and 18 out of Philippians chapter 2 tell us this. This is just fast-forwarding a few verses. He ends the paragraph by saying this. But I will rejoice even if I lose my life, pouring it out like a liquid offering to God, just like your faithful service is an offering to God. And I want all of you to share that joy. Yes, you should rejoice, and I will share your joy. So reminding us, even when we're tempted to complain, even when there are perhaps things we could complain about, we should instead rejoice in the way that God has blessed us. And that, again, going back to the very beginning, that's really what worship is all about. And God calls us to primarily to worship him as Christians. And that's what worship is all about, rejoicing in the fact that God is God and for all the incredible things he's done for us. Rejoicing in that, you know, feeling joy in that. Not complaining about our circumstances, not complaining about the situations we have to go through, but instead learning to trust God and knowing that He sees the big picture. We just see the limited point of view, but he sees the big picture. And being reminded that God walks with us through all of these situations we go through. And I don't know what you're going through this week or this season, but maybe there's something where you've had a tendency to complain. Being reminded that we need to trust God. And instead of complaining, we need to go before God and say, God, help me get through this situation. God, show me how to deal with this situation. God, give me wisdom as to how I should act within this situation. God, give me strength to make it through this situation. Moving from prayers of complaining to prayers of petition. Easier said than done, but we know that through God's strength and the Holy Spirit's leading, He will lead us to do it. Let's pray. Father, we bow before you this evening and we give you thanks for all the prayers in Scripture that we can learn from. God, we're so thankful for that, God, and for teaching us how to pray through your word, Lord, that we're not lost when it comes to how to pray, but that there's so many examples in your word as to how we should pray. And God, may we, when we do have these prayers of complaint, God, help us move those towards prayers of petition as well, God. Not that we would hide things from you or try to sugarcoat the way we feel when we pray, but rather, God, that we'd be genuine and honest and open with you. And not just stopping there, God, but again, moving to petition and asking you to help us through what we're dealing with. Lord, we give you thanks. We thank you for walking with us through whatever we might face, through whatever we might go through. God, we thank you for walking with us through that. Work in our lives this evening, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship.
I do love the Psalms. I love how David, I saw somewhere, some sermon somewhere was talking about how there are actually more laments in Psalms, more lament Psalms than there are simply praise songs. But it shows us how to lament, right? Right? Moving from complaint to petition. David shows us that how we do that. Bring it out before God and say, God, help me. I trust you. And I love that. What a great example. Wherever you are, so cry out to Jesus. Thank you. I'm amazed that you gave us your word, that we actually have your word that we can read. And we're so fortunate in America to be able to read it every day and have maybe 12 of them. God, thank you for your very word spoken to me. God, help me to live like I appreciate this. Help us to live like we appreciate you, Father. Help us to cry out to you and be fed and have your spirit fill our lungs. Thank you, Jesus. I just pray that we go into this week with a renewed sense of your presence, Jesus. God, help us to live more fully in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.